I'm trying to tell it be the place where I be laying low. Flipping in my hometown, niggas ain't tripping, so I get to keep my chrome down. And I be dipping around the spots where the niggas pass with us, serving to the fiends, bitches calling me Mr. Big Buns. Snatching chicks from your mama, making dollars, hoes holler, constantly bringing drama. But I don't sweat it, fool, I come from where the best ride. Ain't no punks where I'm from on that west side. PA nigga, I live town with big nuts. We're out of town, motherfuckers lose their life on the cut. But we ain't tripping past that dippin', it's gon' be alright. Soon as I get fried tonight, yeah, bitch, I got your hope, but hope I break your knees. Full of Dawn, carry on, and water for the jeans.
It's Dawn, carry on, it's supposed to fuck.
Just be like that sometimes.
It's gone, carry on, it's supposed to bubble.
Just be like that sometimes.
It's gone, carry on, it's supposed to bubble.
Just be like that sometimes.
It's gone, carry on, it's supposed to bubble.
Just be like that sometimes, baby.
Well, I'm Pimp Sleep, bitch, I'm smoking big fat dank. I don't fuck around no more with that goddamn drink. But every time I get with my nigga Big Mike, go and get a bottle of that Dawn on ice. I got that green monster, baby, can you buy that? Plus I got switches sweet for days, you wanna try that? I roll them up so big and fat, they look like ball bats. I live in PAT, the east side nigga Sand Jack. These laws be trippin' cause they think I'm selling much crack. You just can't stand to see a nigga rolling Cadillac. But I'm all the cash and I don't think that you can take it back. I feel like golden every day, I think I'm living a Mac. And I ain't trippin', flippin' them switches, taking a trip to the facts. Cause my nigga D called me and said that bitch was gon' be cash.
Yeah, bitch, I got your hoe, but hoe, I break your knees. Full of Dawn, carry on, and water for the jeans.
It's Dawn, carry on, it's supposed to bubble.
Just be like that sometimes.
It's Dawn, carry on, it's supposed to bubble.
Just be like that sometimes. That's real.
It's Dawn, carry on, it's supposed to bubble.
Just be like that sometimes.
And that's real. It's Dawn, carry on, it's supposed to bubble.
Just be like that sometimes, baby.
Now follow me.
Yeah. I wanna say peace to all my, yeah, down for me niggas from PAT. Yo, what's up, D-Ray? Yeah, and the whole Graham family. K-Dawg. Yeah, fool. I wanna say peace to my homeboy Big Mitch and the Queen family. Yeah, I wanna say peace to my homeboy DJ Bird and the Grogan family. Yeah, Bun B, he's still ice to me, fool. Yeah, and the Freeman family. Yeah. And on behalf of my crew and myself and the Butler family, we out. I love y'all. 94 fool. Yeah, we got our props. So now it's time to get our checks. And that's real.
We Japanese still. You getting cooked in front of your family? Like a Japanese meal. It's Yashuba Hibachi, and none of you niggas can stop me. But can't help but watch me. Yo, I've been waiting on this day, man. I've been waiting. Highly anticipated new paper by David Wright. So I'm not going to hold you guys too long with this intro. Let me let my brother up. Drop that banner real quick. Ivry, we got the savant from the Levant in the building. Talk to me.
Shalom. Let's get into these E samples. No, I'm playing. Shalom.
I'm interested in, I was reading on JP58 actually. And what we've been seeing was recapitulated pretty much. So we'll touch on that as well. As far as the e-samples, I haven't read The E sample. Well, I did read some of the E samples. The E1B1B and its role in ancient Neolithic populations. And I want to actually start with the ancient DNA from Mesopotamia suggests this distinct pre-pottery and pottery Neolithic migrations into Anatolia. And the reason why I want to start with that portion is because it's very telling as far as the dispersal of Natufian and early Levantine ancestry going into Europe and going into Anatolia. Sean, check your email. I just sent an email to everybody. Check your email. So I had to get access to see this paper on Science. And I could swear up and down that I purchased my silver membership before. I don't know if it ran out or whatnot, but I couldn't figure it out. So I spent some time doing that. Then I just re-registered and you know, I gained access. So I've been, since I got home from work, I've just been looking over these papers and, you know, gleaning from them. Sean says it's not in his email. Why is it not in your email? Let's see. Yeah, it says I sent it to you. Sigh.
Probably got to give it a little bit of time.
No, he said he got it. So, yeah, while we wait on Sean here, I mean, this is a, you know, huge, huge monumental work, monumental paper. And the reason why is because the enormous amount of samples that were tested. And then when you get into the supplemental information, it talks about all of the samples that they compared it with. And I think it's like 2,200 for one study. And that was just, you know, immense and massive. And some of the conclusions that they come to in these writings, in this paper and the supplemental is just eye-opening, very eye-opening. But like I said before, we were talking about on Clubhouse, Pickrell 2017. Pickrell 2017 basically stated that the farmers that went into the, you know, Europe and contributed to Europe and, you know, proliferated farming that way were pretty much Anatolian related. But this paper is pretty much saying that there was a Levantine, considerable Levantine element. And again, that's eye opening. And also it talks about, Ivory, it talks about the Ibero-Maurusian connection. And I was surprised. I'm like, Ibero-Maurusians have a connection with Yamnaya. And the reason why they have that, it makes sense because these ancient North Africans have been migrating all over the place for thousands of years.
Interesting. Can we go into that? Because I didn't read that part. So did it say that Ibero-Maurusians were in the Near East, or that Yamnaya went into North Africa? Or was it?
No. Yamnaya didn't go into North Africa. From what I was reading, what I got from it was that, yeah, brother, you can. What I was reading is that this North African Levantine influence migrated from those regions into Anatolia, you know, and that's how those components got there. That's how the Yamnaya picked up those components.
I'm sorry, repeat that again, bro. Repeat that again.
The North African Levantine peoples migrated into Anatolia.
Interesting. Okay.
And the surrounding regions. And that's how those elements and components made it in people with Yamnaya-related ancestry. Right? So, I mean, it's clear. It's clear as day if you know, people take out the time. I'm going to be chewing the meat off of this for a couple days. Got Adam in the building. What's going on, Adam?
Hey, guys. Exciting day.
Oh yeah. Very much so.
We've been waiting for this for a little while now. Shalom, Adam. Shalom to the panel.
Shalom, Sean.
Shalom, everyone. Shalom, everyone.
So let me see if I can find that for you real quick, Avery. And I think it's
I think our Burma Rouges are interesting.
I think it's in the it's in the supplementary materials for the genetic history of the Southern Arc. Right, it's in that one. So if you hard search, let me see. The I'm sorry, y'all. I'm gassed from work and then looking over this information. The Tafaroff.
There's a little bit. They touch on it a little bit in the results. So I don't know if that's it's like a synopsis, but I know you're looking for the meat of it. I'm looking at it now in the results. They make mention of it.
Yeah, read that real quick while I pull this up.
Let me see. Where are we at? Steep pastoralists of the Yamnaya culture initiated a chain of migration linking Europe in the West to China, just like you said earlier today on Clubhouse issue, China and India in the East. Some people across the Balkans about 5,000 to 4,500 years ago trace almost all their genes to this expansion. Steep migration soon admixed with locals, creating a tapestry of diverse ancestry from which speakers of the Greek, Paleo-Balkan, and Albanian languages arose. The Yamnaya expansion also crossed the Caucasus, and by about 4,000 years ago, Armenia had become an enclave of a low but pervasive steep ancestry in West Asia, where the patrilineal descendants of Yamnaya men, virtually extinct on the steppe, persisted. The Armenian language was born there, related to Indo-European languages of Europe, such as Greek, by their shared Yamnaya heritage. Neolithic Anatolians in modern Turkey were descended from both local hunter-gatherers and eastern populations of the Caucasus, Mesopotamia, and the Levant. By about 6,500 years ago and thereafter, Anatolians became more genetically homogeneous, a process driven by the flow of eastern ancestry across the peninsula. Earlier forms of Anatolian and non-Indo-European languages such as Hattic and Hurrian were likely spoken by migrants and locals participating in the Great Mixture. Hold on, I just gotta scroll up a little bit. Anatolia is remarkable for its lack of steppe ancestry down to the Bronze Age. The ancestry of the Yamnaya was, by contrast, only partly local. Half of it was West Asian from both the Caucasus and the more southern Anatolian Levantine continuum. Migration into the steppe started about 7,000 years ago, making the later expansion of the Yamnaya into the Caucasus a return to the homeland of about half their ancestry. That's where it leaves off at.
Yeah. So watch this, y'all. So this is the supplemental for that paper. So the Yamnaya, they got components that come from the Levant, right? The southern Levant. He just read it.
Mm-hmm.
Check this out. So within the supplementals, if you go to page 195, you'll see table S 16, Balkan, miscellaneous 1. And if you guys can see this, let me blow this up. The fourth row, you see the Tafaroff component. And in the fifth row, you also see that Tafaroff component, and they make notes on this. It says here, we were intrigued by the fact that the few individuals of the Balkan miscellaneous 1 cluster show ancestry from Epipaleolithic North Africans represented by Tafaroff, while otherwise possessing the same types of ancestry as the bigger Balkan cluster. So that's what I was referring to, Avery.
Oh, all right. Interesting.
Yeah. There was some really interesting information on phenotype distribution. What they found was that the Yamayans were not pale-skinned. That the pale skin comes from the Beaker group, which is predominantly West pre-Yamayan Western European, kind of Celtic. That the corded and Yamayan clusters were where the prevalence of light pigmentation was rare, and the Yamayan cluster was very rare.
Yeah, that's what's up. I've seen that too. Also,
so the Yamayan would have been kind of dark skinned.
Yes, darker skin.
Not necessarily. They may not have necessarily been very, very dark skinned, but they were. You know, they weren't as pale as we would think they would be. So
yeah, I think they classify it as like there's like light pigmentation. I'll get back to you here on the exact terminology. There's like there's light, there's dark, and then there's dark to black.
There's also intermediate. Did it say intermediate?
Intermediate. Yes. Yeah. The intermediate. Right.
Yeah. So that would be like the people that you would see in the movie 10,000 BC. So, I mean, if we was to put a phenotype of color on them for the intermediate, that's what I would assume they're alluding to.
So they find that light skin pigmentation isn't present in the southern arc. Blue eyes are, as is blonde hair.
Very
Catholic and Neolithic. Copper Age Levant and Neolithic Anatolia.
So basically, there were tan-skinned, blonde-haired, blue-eyed people.
In part, it was a mix. There's a graph that shows like the distribution going back 10,000 years with the prevalence of light pigmentation over the span.
Exactly what part that would be at? So, because Yashub has the paper up already, so maybe we can look into that as well at some point. I know Yashub wants to cover the certain parts that he's picked out. So, I mean, basically, it's a lot for us to work through, and we just got the paper within 2 hours ago. We was just on Clubhouse discussing it, so it's going to be a lot. We might have to do this over a couple of days.
I also found this very specific aspects where they reference the Natufians and the new samples from Israel that they cite as well. So I found that it's interesting.
Yeah, bring that out.
Yeah, is it a supplementary? We'd like to.
Do you want to start start with that one? Okay.
Yeah,
let me just a moment here. I'm looking at the. This is the supplementary materials for the genetic history of the Southern Arc, a bridge between West Asia and Europe.
You want to share or
what page?
Just a moment. We're looking at. Hold on here. We're looking at page. It's figure S50 Israel. The title is 251. The content is page number 252. And in it, it speaks about the pre-Neolithic, Neolithic, pre-pottery, and I think Copper Age Levant.
All right, so I see the admixture tables here. Is this what you're referring to?
Yeah, if you go, it should be page, go down one. I think you need to go further down. It should be page 252. Yeah, there we go. 254, yeah, a little bit up.
So this is Israel in the Bronze Age.
Yeah, go further up there. Yeah, so this is it here.
Okay, I see.
Yeah, so this is where it gets into the meat and potatoes.
I read this, yeah. Yeah, I read all of this. Let's see. It says, in samples from Israel, in this study, the Levantine ancestry is the most important one in all periods. Note that we model Epipaleolithic, not Natufians, that precede the Neolithic as derived from the Levantine Neolithic. It has previously been inferred that these can be modeled as a mixture of the Levantine Neolithic with North African Epipaleolithic. We use the QP Atom or ADM to confirm that this model fits the North African input. In the five-way model used to model individuals here, the North African source is not included, and hence Natufians are modeled as entirely Levantine Neolithic. When we use the QP wave to test whether the Levantine Neolithic forms a clade with Natufians, this model fails. Examining the statistics of the form, it's Levantine pre-pottery Neolithic, Natufian Epipaleolithic, and Mbuti for different outgroups. This is significantly positive for the X equals Turkey, Marmara, and X equals Epipaleolithic of Anatolia, suggesting that there is shared genetic drift between the Anatolian-related populations and the pre-pottery Neolithic of the Levant that was not shared by Natufians. In 11, we show populations in the PPN Neolithic of the Levant that was not shared by the, excuse me, I just reread that. And we show, in 11, we show two opportunities for the establishment of this shared drift. First, that the Levantine Neolithic can be modeled as a mixture of Pinarbasi and the Natufians, i.e. Anatolian-related influence in the Levant prior to the formation of the Levantine Neolithic. Second, that the population sampled at Barsin could be modeled with 12.8 plus or minus 3.3% Levantine Neolithic and 26.8 plus or minus 4.5% Mesopotamian Neolithic ancestry, i.e. Levantine-related influence contributing to the formation of the pottery Neolithic in Anatolia. I want to just, this goes back to what we were talking about earlier. Ivory, if you're still here, I think I heard somebody dropped out.
No, I'm here. I'm here.
About this Levantine ancestry being driven into this region. Let me keep reading.
Into the Anatolia.
Yeah. It says, to summarize our observation, the data suggests that Natufian Epipaleolithic is not cladal with the PPN formers of the Levant, but can only be modeled with some North African input. The PPN formers of the Levant in turn share genetic drift with both Epipaleolithic and Neolithic Anatolians, which can stem from either admixture prior to their own formation or a Levantine contribution via Mesopotamia or directly to the forming populations of Anatolia. It says in the Chalcolithic, three sources are needed. Approximately 2/3 of the ancestry is Levantine Neolithic. Approximately 1/4 Anatolian Neolithic, and the remainder, approximately 1/7, related to Caucasus hunter-gatherer. The Caucasus hunter-gatherer ancestry rises to approximately 1/3 in the Bronze and Iron Age. I wonder why, Ivory.
I need to read that part one more time.
Yeah,
get such an influx in the Bronze and Iron? It says the Levantine ancestry is reduced in each successive epoch, reaching approximately 42% in the Iron Age. Of course,
it reduces dilution. Oh, my bad.
Right. Of course, there is variability in the Iron Age, as we will see below. No clear pattern emerges for the Anatolian Neolithic, whose temporary dip in the Bronze Age is restored by the Iron Age.
There's a couple of papers that explain why that happened, but essentially, by the time of the Iron Age, you see that dip in Neolithic Levantine DNA is because of groups such as the Hurrians, which would have carried Zagros, Iranian, and Armenian Caucasian DNA.
Mm-hmm. Right, right. Elijah just even talks about that in his 2016 paper.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they're crossing papers here too. They said that in the beginning of the paper that they cross-reference like three different papers for this. So, and so Lazard was there as well. Lazard's paper was included.
And to complement what's being discussed here, there is in the ancient DNA from Mesopotamia suggests distinct pre-pottery and pottery Neolithic migrations into Anatolia. In the general paper, not the subsection, it has a graph that breaks down population. Distributions. It's figure four. It's called the dilution of Neolithic ancestry in the Levant, and it provides the Levant samples and the contributing, Barson, Levant PPN, and Caucasus hunter gatherer contributions to the region dating from 10,000 years before prior to the present. And it shows the sort of distribution, and what it really shows is that around there's sort of like a cross of similar distribution of all three populations in the Levant circa 6,000 years before present.
So 4,000 BC.
Yeah. And Caucasus hunter-gatherers start making a major contribution, and the major contribution starting about 7,500 years before present, and there's a huge upswing to about 4,000 years before present, 4,500 years before present. And that's in figure four.
Right. You got very little Serbian. Here, let me go down. What figure is this one?
Yeah, it's... If you keep on going down, I think it's below that.
Yeah, I want to highlight some things. And I want to actually read this, but...
There it is.
Yeah, I saw this earlier. So the caucus hunter gatherer input, as you can see, it increases like we just read around the Bronze Age. We see
so the Copper Age there at about 6,000 years before present, where you see all three groups with relatively similar
they merge, yeah,
proportions.
So this jives with the genomic history of the Southern Levant. The other paper that we had, was that 2018? I'm saying am I saying the title right?
Yeah, you're talking about the one with the T markers.
Yes.
No. He said the genomic history. That's 2020. That's like,
yeah, the new one.
Last year or the year
before? Yeah, the one that we just recently did a live on.
But the T markers explains this because they would have the,
yeah, because they had Anatolian. Yeah,
they would have Anatolian, so that explains the Barson. And also that would explain Caucasus hunter-gatherer as well. And the PPN, of course, because they mix with those people. But you're right, they all converge around that 6,000-year mark. But as you can see, the pre-pottery Neolithic farmers, they begin to decrease towards the Iron Age. But you see an increase of Caucasus hunter gather DNA, you know, towards the Iron Age. It's like
those would be your Canaanites, your Hurrian Canaanites.
Yeah, the Anatolian is kind of like up and down. It's not really spiking.
Right.
Yeah, because Anatolian was a little bit more distinct from the Zagros DNA.
Right.
Yeah.
But doesn't in that previous statement, weren't they? It seemed like they were he was redefining the PPN, genetic makeup.
right? That it was suggesting that it was Mesopotamian and Anatolian.
The
with a Natufian admixture.
And the pre-pottery Neolithic.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, pre-pottery Neolithic. Let me go back and look at that. I didn't get that from that, but hold on. Let me see. Maybe I'm missing something. It says, to summarize our observation, the data suggests that Natufian Paleolithic is not cladded with the PPN farmers of the Levant, but can only be modeled with some North African input. The PPN farmers of the Levant, in turn, share genetic drift with both Epipaleolithic and Neolithic Anatolians, which can stem from either an admixture prior to their own formation or a Levantine contribution via Mesopotamia or directly to the farming populations of Anatolia. Yeah, so what I interpret that is that they got those things by migrating into Mesopotamia and Anatolia, and that's where you get the spread of farming from. That's how I interpret it.
Right.
But they don't share a clade with Natufian.
Who doesn't?
The PPN.
That's not what that's saying. So if you go to the
PPN, scroll to it. Scroll to it so everybody can see it.
Hold on. Let me go to Lazarus. Let me pull up Lazarus.
All right.
Let me see. Lazarus is 2016, real quick. At least that's not what I'm seeing, so maybe you can correct me.
I know that pre-pottery Neolithic Levantines had E, but other pre-pottery Neolithic populations throughout the Middle East could have had different haplogroups, but the Levantines definitely had E.
Yeah, but they had like later populate like PPNB, because it says PPN farmers of Levant.
Oh, so it's talking about Levantines?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, they're going to have E, definitely.
Now, you do have, that's why I'm trying to pull it up real quick, because I don't remember all the clades. I know you do have, like, ancient stuff there.
I know it goes from, like, Neolithic E with the Levant, then Chalcolithic Copper Age with T and E, and then in the Bronze Age with J, so E, T, and J.
Yeah. So if you go to Lazarus' work that he wrote in 2016, Adam, you can see the, the haplogroups.
It says here, to summarize our observations, the data suggests that the Natufian Epipaleolithic is not cladal with the PPN farmers of the Levant, but can only be modeled with some North African input.
Right.
Where the PPN farmers share genetic drift with the pre-Neolithic and Neolithic Anatolians, which is an admixture.
I'll ask Razi Khan about that, because I'm not getting what you're getting out of it. I see what you're saying. But when you look at the ancient Near Eastern, there's of course all of Israel, not Tufian. We all know about that one. But the PPN,
there's a newer paper, actually, you shoot, that has those CTs as E markers.
Yep.
I can pull it up for you if you want.
Yeah, pull it for me. But look at this. H2. Pre-pottery Neolithic. This is all the Levant. Then you have a E, ancestor E. Then you have E1, B1, B1, and the PPNB. You have another one, enlisted CT. And then you have the T marker.
Right, but those CTs have been confirmed, you said, right? I mean, I know.
And on the ones in Israel, yeah, as E. Okay. And then you have another one right here, E1, B1, B1.
All right. In the private chat, put it in where those CTs are E markers. They've been confirmed. And right. You can push the link.
This is the supplementary information for the genomic insights into the origin of farming in the ancient Near East.
Right. What year is this paper again?
2016.
Yeah, it's old.
That's the one. That's the one that Jacob Israel tried to hit me with.
I don't know how, but
hit him with the new one that I posted in Side Chat Show.
Yeah, I know, but I also had the other confirmation when they confirmed the CTs and the Natufian CTs and the Levant in Israel.
It's in the supplement.
It's in the Side Chat.
I mean, is it in the supplementary materials? I got the page.
No, it's going to be, by the way, we can't see it, but let me look through it myself. Scroll down. It's not going to be in the supplement. Well, it will be in the supplementary, but you can actually read it in the actual paper as well. Just scroll down to ancient Y-DNA diversity in Africa, and it will be there. And we can't see your screen.
I know. Hold on. All right. I got it.
All right, so it has all the samples, Jordan, pre-pottery Neolithic B, ancient Middle Easterners, et cetera, et cetera. You should be able to read it in the...
I got you.
Yeah.
Hold on. There it is.
Even what's interesting about this paper is that it even shows ancient haplogroup A and B in sub-Saharan Africa, and that these are like some of the oldest clades in Africa, which fits the whole Hamite hypothesis. But anyways, go ahead.
I'm looking for the Levant samples you said that was here.
Yeah, scroll down, and it's going to show maps. There's the A and B, like I said.
Oh, I see.
E. Yeah.
The PPMB, yeah, right there. All E1, B1B.
Yeah, and if you scroll down further, it has a little reading that you can read that breaks it down. It's all the way the last three paragraphs of this section.
And what years before present are the samples?
Those are the same samples from
it's in the Yashu, can you scroll down to the last three paragraphs, and you can read it out from there. Starting with the one that says the next clade.
Yeah, it says the next clade on which we'll focus on is EM78, which has a broad geographical range which encompasses North and East Africa, Europe, and Western Asia. All Morocco, Iberomaurusians were positioned in this clade, as well as a Jordan pre-pottery Neolithic B individual.
Yeah, that's what I mean right there.
Yeah.
But keep reading.
A single East African... what is this? Pastoralist.
That's EV32.
Yeah, that's PN is pastoralist Neolithic sample was placed in the EV32 clay together with a Luya, an Iranian individual. The Egypt Ptolemaic sample, a late Stone Age and pastoral Neolithic individual were placed in the EL677 clay, which can be found in the present day in the Horn of Africa and Egypt. In our data, this clade is represented by Palestinians.
A lot of Palestinians got E.
Yes, they do. 32%, I believe.
I can't remember, but it's in
the about 30. It's in the 30s.
Is this the North African that Reich is referencing in his modeling?
It could be. Or at least one of them, because there's a couple of, even in this paper, it says right there, three Moroccan early Neolithic samples carry, you know, that.
Yeah, that's the Tafarat. So anytime they say ancient North African, they're talking about the Moroccan sample.
And if you scroll down a little bit more, Yashub, it talks more about the Levant. Can you go down a little bit more? Because that's talking about North Africa. It's interesting, but we need to focus on the Levant. I think it says it right there, a sublineage of EZ830 found in Levantine
agriculture, Natufian, and pre-pottery Neolithic B Levantine sample.
Mm-hmm.
Sister to the EZ1145 lineage is still found in the Middle East. Subset of those East African pastoral Neolithics were further assigned to the EM293 lineage, which is a descendant of the Northeast African EV1515. And has been proposed to be associated with the spread of pastoralism from the East to South Africa. In our data set, this clade is represented by Bantu from Kenya and South Africa, one Maasai and two Luya individuals from Kenya. Additionally, one early pastoral and two pastoral Iron Age individuals from Tanzania are placed in the E2AM41 clade. That it? Yeah, that's it.
Very interesting.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah, that's it. That's what I meant by
the confirmation.
The pre-potter Neolithic Levantines being E markers.
Yeah, they're obviously connected. So I'm trying to. I think I see what you're trying to say by saying they're non-cladal. I think it meaning they don't have anything to do with each other, but I'm not seeing that. I don't think that's what that passage means. But I will ask Razib Khan tomorrow, if I were you, about that passage. Where's that paper at? I got so many damn tabs open. And I just accidentally, closed one too.
Dang, how many tabs you got open? 20? Like me right now.
All right, so let's actually go. Let's dig into this paper real quick. Stop this. Hey, NYR Yahoo, activate your mic and your camera, and you'll be able to join the live.
Who's that?
Naira from him and William be running together. Him and Will. Will son of y'all. You know Naira.
Oh, okay.
Naira, yeah.
All right, so watch this. Because I wanted to look into this one first because I was very intrigued by this anyway, right? It says here, and you can see ancient DNA from Mesopotamia suggests distinct pre-pottery and pottery Neolithic migrations into Anatolia. And you see Ios of Lazarus being one of the geneticists, along with like almost 200. It says connecting genes and history. Stories about the peopling and the people of Southern Europe and West Asia have been passed down for thousands of years. And these stories have contributed to our historical understanding of populations. Genomic data provide the opportunity to truly understand these patterns independently from written history. In a trio of papers, Lazarus et al. Examined more than 700 ancient genomes from across this region, the Southern Arc, spanning 11,000 years from the earliest farming cultures to post-medieval times. See the perspective by Arbuckle and Swan. On the basis of these results, the author suggests that earlier reliance on modern phenotypes in ancient writings and artistic depictions provided an accurate picture of early Indo-Europeans, and they provide a revised history of the complex migration and population integration that shaped these cultures. And that's huge. This is huge because, again, reliance on modern phenotypes. And this is the issue that a lot of people have. I mean, we always, you know, get on the BHIs for this. Just looking at phenotype and then trying to superimpose ancestry solely based on phenotype. Let me keep reading this. It says here, we present the first ancient DNA data from the pre-pottery Neolithic of Mesopotamia, southeastern Turkey and northern Iraq, Cyprus and northwestern Zagros, along with the first data from Neolithic Armenia. Also, real quick side note before I keep reading this. There's an Iraqi sample here, Ivory.
Oh, really? Mesopotamian? Like modern Iraq?
No, it was like the date was like Iron Age.
Okay, so that's pretty good.
It was, I think it was J. I think it was
J. Iron Age.
Okay. I'll see if I can pull it up here in a minute. Because look, it says Northern Iraq here, right?
Oh, that's true. That's true.
It says we present the first ancient DNA data from the pre-pottery Neolithic of Mesopotamia. It says we show that these neighboring populations were formed through admixture of pre-Neolithic sources related to Anatolian Caucasus and Levantine hunter-gatherers, forming a Neolithic continuum of ancestry mirroring the geography of West Asia. By analyzing pre-pottery and pottery Neolithic populations of Anatolia, we show that the former were derived from admixture between Mesopotamian related and local epipaleolithic related sources, but the latter experienced additional Levantine related gene flow, thus documenting at least two pulses of migration from the Fertile Crescent heartland to the early farmers of Anatolia. This previous work has documented, what were you saying, Avery?
No, my bad. I was just saying very interesting during that pause.
It says previous work has documented the existence of highly differentiated Neolithic populations in ancient West Asia and some of their pre-Neolithic ancestors in the Caucasus, Iran, Anatolia, and the Levant. To anchor our integrative genomic history of the Southern Arc, a region we define as including Anatolia and its neighbors in Southeastern Europe and West Asia, we sought to understand how the earliest Neolithic populations were formed, with a particular focus on the pre-pottery period of northern or upper Mesopotamia. The area between the Tigris and Euphrates River of southeastern Turkey, northwestern Iraq, and northeastern Assyria within the pre-pottery Neolithic interaction sphere. Despite the centrality of Mesopotamian archaeological record of the origin of farming, no genome-wide ancient DNA data from early Mesopotamian farmers have been published. We used in solution enrichment for 1.2 million single nucleotide polymorphisms, SNPs, to study pre-pottery Neolithic farmers from the Tigris side of northern Mesopotamia. One from Bankuklu, Tarla, near Mardin, in southeastern Turkey, and two from Nimrik 9 in northern Iraq. We also report the first pre-pottery Neolithic data from Cyprus, an island to the south of the Anatolian Peninsula and west of the Levant, which witnessed the earliest maritime expansion of pre-pottery farmers from the eastern Mediterranean. Our data comes from three individuals whose fragmentary remains were found in a Neolithic disused and filled in water well at the Kisnierga. This says, furthermore, we report the first ancient DNA data from the Neolithic of Armenia from two individuals buried at the sites of Massus Blur and Akhnashim in the 6th millennium BCE. These individuals represent an inland pottery Neolithic population, which we could compare to the pre-pottery one from the northern Mesopotamia to its south, the pottery Neolithic one of Azerbaijan to its east, and later the Chalcolithic individuals from Armenia. Finally, we sampled three pre-pottery Neolithic farmers from the northern Zagros at Bestansor and the Zawi Chimi components of the Shah Nidar cave in Iraq, who fill a gap between the more western and northern individuals and published data from the central Zagros in Iran. Details of the newly sampled individuals can be found in 12, and their geographical temporal distributions can be seen in figure 1. To improve the statistical power of our analysis, we also increased data quality for a number of individuals with previously reported data, making and sequencing additional ancient DNA libraries from our epipaleolithic Natufians from Israel, six pre-pottery Neolithic individuals from Jordan, and nine Neolithic individuals from eastern Marmara region, northwest Anatolia sites of Barsin and Mentasek. From eastern Marmara, we also sampled an individual from Barsin and two from previously unsampled sites of, two L's, I-P-I-N-A-R. So individuals from the three sites were genetically similar, and we analyzed them together with later calculated individuals from the same site in a study of the later periods of Anatolia. And then they have all the sites of the samples that they have here. Of course, in the Levant, you're going to see Natufi in that orange circle here and the Levant PPN. So the bold line is the Levant PPN, pre-pottery, and then the one without the bold line is the Levant. And as you can see on the left going up is the time. So 12,000, between 12,000 to 14,000 BP, years before present, the Natufians existed. Hey, Avery, here you go. The Caucasus hunter-gatherer in Satserbia. We know a lot about him, don't we?
Jay.
Yeah.
You also see that Zagros Iranian right there.
Mm-hmm. And then I think Adam had a question about what time frame. It right here, the PPN is between 10 and 12,000 years before present.
Mm-hmm.
For these individuals, at least. And then down here, they're a little.
It's like 10,000.
Yeah. Yeah, around there.
All the way through pre-pottery, and then pottery is sort of 8,500 mm-hmm. to, yeah, kind of 8,000, let's say.
All right.
Yep, yep.
So the Barson sample right here, where did he put this? About 9,000? Somewhere around that time. It says figure one studied individuals. It says time frame of the pre-Neolithic, pre-pottery Neolithic, and pottery Neolithic populations of West Asia. Geographical location of populations on the B side. And then it says from A shown on the maps in West Asia. It says we carried out a principal component analysis projecting the ancient individuals onto the variation of present-day West Eurasians. Two main clusters emerge, an Eastern Mediterranean Anatolian Levantine cluster that also includes geographically intermediate individuals from Cyprus and an inland Zagros, Caucasus, Mesopotamia, Armenia, Azerbaijan cluster. There is a structure within these groupings. Anatolian individuals group with each other and with those from Cyprus, whereas Levantine individuals are distinct. Within the inland cluster, individuals that are more geographically distant from the Mediterranean, such as those from the South Caucasus, Caucasus hunter-gatherers from Georgia, and the Gange, the Ray from Central Zagros, are also genetically more distant as compared with geographically and genetically intermediate individuals from Mesopotamia and Armenia / Azerbaijan. The Eastern Mediterranean and inland clusters are separated by a gap in figure 2A, which may correspond to geographically intermediate areas between sampling locations. For example, the Euphrates region of North Mesopotamia. The totality of the Neolithic West Asia is enclosed within the range of variation of the quadrangle.
You're good.
Yeah, that's it.
I never heard of this word.
Quadrangle. Yeah, I know, right?
Quadrangle.
David Reich's Shakespeare all of a sudden. He's inventing words.
Quadrangle. Is that like a four-sided
Four sides.
Yeah.
Formed by Caucasus hunter-gatherers, the Gange, the Levantine Natufians from Israel, and Epipaleolithic Panarbasi from Central Anatolia. All right, and here's the graph for that.
When you write your book, or when we write our books, we promise to not
use quadrangle.
Have words like that.
Oh, I thought you were going to say it's the title.
It says, "All right, so this is what the Levantine, of course, they cluster with each other. The Anatolians cluster with each other. I mean, this makes sense. This is nothing like." Surprising. Unless it's something you guys see.
Yes, this makes a lot of sense.
Yeah.
So the Levant PPNs are the bold orange letters. I mean, orange circles. And then you see the Natufians here. They're not closely clustered.
No, yeah, they're more closely related to the Anatolians.
Yeah, all right here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This is where they converge. That's interesting.
It's basically how we've been following the data all this time. It makes sense.
Yeah. So that's why where'd that supplement at? Did I close that?
So what we're looking at there is like anywhere between 8 and 10,000 years ago, basically.
Yeah. Yeah. That PPN period.
Yeah.
And then when you look over here, these individuals are tightly clustered. Who are these individuals?
Those are probably the northern Anatolians.
Those are the, no, the, yeah.
Or are those the, or the Cyprus?
No, you're right. No. You're right. It's the people in Barsin.
Yeah.
In Turkey. Yeah, they're tightly clustered. There's no,
which makes, like, which basically we're seeing here as like a left is north to right is south. And it makes sense because it's the northern Levant, kind of modern day northern Syria, southern Turkey, which is the epicenter, I think, of kind of agrarian and some of the pottery societies, right?
Yeah, and also
as well as Semitic.
Yeah, yeah. So you see those purple, the purple ones are the Cyprus PPNB, right? And that makes sense because you see a lot of J2. You see J2 associated with like Cyprus and early Greece, and then you see J2 also in Anatolia. So,
that's later too, right? That would be like, that's like 3,000 years before present, perhaps. Like this is considerably older.
I think so. Yeah, I think they're in the Mycenaean. What's Mycenaeans? Mycenaeans. They're Bronze Age, right?
Mycenaeans will be Bronze Age because the Mycenaean civilization collapsed during the late Bronze Age.
Yeah. Armenians, they're all the way up. Where are they at? Up here. They're up here. Then the Iraq guys here. The PPN Iraqian. So they're spaced. They're not even tightly clustered. They're kind of spaced out.
Yeah.
All right, let me look at the Southern Caucasus one. I don't see this one. Where's this one on the graph?
Scroll down a little bit. Let's see. Scroll down a little bit. I don't see it either. Oh, it's one right there. It's one right above Mesopotamia.
What I'm seeing is the Iraqi samples are very, very much caucus hunter-gatherers.
Yeah.
With a bit of Levant PPN mixed in.
Yeah, but who are these circles here? It doesn't say over here on the key.
I think those are, is that, that's the basal South Caucasus, I think.
I don't see it on the ground.
It's not there, no. I'm reaching.
Oh, there it is.
Oh, there it is. Yeah, focus on the gatherers.
Yeah.
Focus on the gatherers.
All right. And so I guess those two, the Armenian Azerbaijan. One of those two right there. Is that? No, there it is here. Azerbaijan Neolithic. Okay. All right. Overview of the Neolithic variation. Principal component analysis of ancient individuals projected onto West Eurasian variation. Application of five-way model from 12 to Neolithic populations with Caucasus hunter-gatherers, Eastern European hunter-gatherers, Levant pre-pottery Neolithic, Serbian, Iron Gate hunter-gatherers, and Northwestern Anatolian Neolithic from Barsin sources. It says, in a linked study, we developed a mathematical framework for estimating the ancestry proportions of individuals of the entire Southern Arc across space and time with a common metric. And here we discuss the results of applying this model to the Neolithic period. This model includes Caucasus hunter-gatherers, Eastern European hunter-gatherers, Levantine pre-pottery Neolithic, Balkan hunter-gatherers from the Iron Gates in Serbia, and Anatolian Neolithic from Barsin in the Marmara region of Northwest Anatolia as surrogates for five ancestry sources. Within this framework, the highest proportion of Anatolian Neolithic related ancestry is observed in Neolithic Anatolian populations, as well as the early forms of Cyprus. The Balkan hunter-gatherers related affinity and pre-pottery population at Ban Kuklu, and the Epipaleolithic one from Pinarbasi, both of which predate the pottery Neolithic from Barsin by thousands of years. Does not indicate that these older individuals were admixed with European hunter-gatherers. Rather, it reflects the fact that in comparison to the Barsin population, both Pinarbasi and Ban Kuklu were less Levantine, a finding that is consistent with the Levantine influx into the pottery Neolithic population that is revealed by the analysis that follows. A contrast in cases that of the Natufians, who are inferred to be more Levantine among the Anatolian Levantine clan, and are unsurprisingly inferred to derive all of their ancestry from the Levant pre-pottery Neolithic source. This, of course, does not mean that the earlier Natufians are descended from the pre-pottery Neolithic farmers that followed them, but rather both share ancestry. So I think this is what that supplementary portion was referring to.
The one that Adam was referring to, right? The one that Adam, yeah.
It says, in reality, from Natufians to the pre-pottery Neolithic farmers. Yeah. So the Natufians, the ancestry from the Natufians shifted to the pre-pottery Neolithic farmers.
They contributed, yes.
Right. Which is modeled in this way within the limitations of the five-way model. Similarly, the Ganj Dare population's most extreme of the inland group derives all of its ancestry from the Caucasus hunter-gatherer source used in the five-way model. Caucasus hunter-gatherer related ancestry levels are high in all inland populations, that is, of the northern Zagros, Armenia, Azerbaijan, as well as those of North Mesopotamia. The high Anatolian related ancestry in Cyprus revealed by this model and subsequent analysis sheds light on the debates about the origins of people who spread pre-pottery Neolithic cultures to Cyprus. Parallels in subsistence technology, settlement organization, and ideological indicators suggest close contacts between pre-pottery Neolithic B people in Cyprus and on the mainland. But the geographic source of the Cypriot pre-pottery Neolithic population has been unclear, with many possible points of origin. And an inland Middle Euphrates source has been suggested on the basis of architectural and artifactual similarities. However, the faunal record at Cypriot, am I saying it was Cypriot or Cypriot?
Cypriot, tomato.
Cypriot pre-pottery Neolithic B sites and the uses of the Anatolian obsidian as raw material suggests linkages with central and southern Anatolia, and the genetic data increases the weight of the evidence in favor of this scenario of primary source in Anatolia. So people of Cyprus most likely came derived their ancestry from Anatolians. Why they graph so close on the PCA.
C kind of gives you that distribution.
I'll be kind of grab that ad mixture and the gange. It says A is a three-way model of the Neolithic ad mixture with Caucasus hunter-gatherers as a source. B is a three-way model of Neolithic ad mixture with the Ganj Dare as a source. Caucasus hunter-gatherer and Ganj Dare admixture proportions for A and B are strongly correlated. We also model Neolithic population with local Anatolian, Pinarbasi, and Eastern Mesopotamian pre-pottery Neolithic proximal sources. Both pre-pottery Neolithic population from Anatolia have no significant evidence for extra Levantine ancestry. However, all three pottery Neolithic ones from Barsin and Northwest Anatolia and Tepecik and Kartalhoyuk in central Anatolia have significant additional Levantine ancestry. And I think the reason why this is because what we read here earlier, let me go back up. Where is it? Right here, it said a finding that is consistent with the 11th influx into the pottery Neolithic populations that is revealed by the analysis that follows. A contrasted case that the Natufians, who are inferred to be more Levantine along the Anatolian Levantine climb and are unsurprisingly inferred to derive all of their ancestry from the Levant pre-pottery Neolithic source. This, of course, does not mean that the early Natufians are descended from the pre-pottery Neolithic farmers that followed them, but rather that they both share ancestry, in reality, from the Natufians to the pre-pottery Neolithic farmers. Go back down here. I think we're here. It says, however, all three pottery Neolithic ones from Barsin in Northwest Anatolia, Tepecik and Katalhöyük in Central Anatolia have significant additional Levantine ancestry. Ancestry proportion for some groups are non-significantly negative, reflecting statistical uncertainty in the estimates. The two individuals from Armenia from the sites of Akhnaten, approximately 5,900 BCE, and Masir Blur, approximately 5,600 BCE, differ in being more Caucasus and Anatolian Levant-like. Respectfully, despite being buried just less than 200 kilometers and a few centuries apart, thus Neolithic people of Armenia were not homogenous, but instead exhibited variation that also encompassed two approximately 5,700 to 5,400 BCE individuals buried in the neighboring Azerbaijan, who are intermediate between the two from Armenia in both PCA and the five-way model. But in comparison to the individuals from Mesopotamia to the south, the individuals from Armenia and Azerbaijan had more Anatolian Neolithic admixture, visible in both PCA and the five-way model. Conversely, some Neolithic Anatolian populations from Central Anatolia had Caucasus hunter-gatherer related admixture more than Penobarsi, and the Northwest Anatolian source population where such ancestry is not evident, but less than the proportion of fair for the individual from Mardin on Southeast Anatolia, which belonged together with its neighbors at Nemrik 9 in Northern Iraq to the inland group characterized by high Caucasus hunter-gatherer related ancestry. These observations form a consistent picture of a Neolithic continuum characterized by Anatolian / Levantine climb on one end and an inland influence related to the Zagros Caucasus set of populations, with the geographically intermediate individuals from Mesopotamia, Armenia, Azerbaijan occupying genetically intermediate positions. As to avoid publication order bias, that is the tendency to update published models to accommodate new data, rather than always inferring models taking all samples equally into account. We co-analyze new data from the Neolithic together with previously published data to arrive at a model of Neolithic origins that can account for the patterns of genetic variation in the Neolithic West Asia as a whole. The Neolithic continuum emerges from this analysis too, as all the Neolithic populations under study can be modeled as mixtures of three pre-Neolithic sources, representing Anatolian, Levantine, Natufian, and inland sources, either Caucasus hunter-gatherer as in figure 3A or Ganges Dare as in figure 3B. The two inland sources are not independent, but to a first degree of approximation represent the same source of ancestry. When we attempt to model Neolithic populations using either Caucasus hunter-gatherers or the Ganges Dare as a source population and the others as an outgroup, we obtain good model fits for most populations, further suggesting that neither population is a better source than the other, except for the high Caucasus hunter-gatherer ancestry individual from Akhnaten, where the Caucasus hunter-gatherer model is not rejected, while the Ganges Dare one is. The Azerbaijan and Mesopotamian Neolithic, for which both models are rejected, and the Barsin Neolithic, for which Ganges Dare model is narrowly not rejected at the P equals 0.01 level. While the Caucasus hunter-gatherer one is rejected, these results tentatively suggest that the Caucasus hunter-gatherers and the Ganges Dare Neolithic are interchangeable for the purpose of quantifying the amount of inland admixture. Although some populations may have clear connection with one or the other, For example, Neolithic of Armenia with the hunter-gatherer of the South Caucasus rather than Iran, and the geographically intermediate Azerbaijan and Mesopotamia with both. The fact that regardless of the chosen sources, none of the Neolithic populations of West Asia were simple descendants of their pre-Neolithic antecedents. When we had the data to test this, in which case some of them would occupy the corner positions of figure 3A and B, suggest that some history of admixture may have led to their appearance. The details of this process could be elucidated by examining even older populations from across West Asia. When pre-Neolithic antecedents are not available, as in the case for North Mesopotamia, it remains an open question whether the local hunter-gatherers were genetically continuous with the first farmers of the region, or if there was a history of admixture across the Neolithic transition there as well. Notably, this highlights that intermediate populations of the ternary plots of figure 3 need not have come about by admixture from the corner populations used to model them. Alternatively, they could be drawn toward the middle by unsampled pre-Neolithic populations of West Asia. For example, hunter-gatherers of the Tigris and Euphrates regions predating the pre-pottery Neolithic farmers studied here. When we attempted to model Neolithic populations as mixtures of each other, we observed that at least in Anatolia, where most of the data from which both pre-pottery and pottery Neolithic populations have been published, an interesting distinction became clear. Pre-pottery Neolithic populations from central Anatolia can be modeled as mixtures of a group related to local Pinarbasi epipaleolithic with variable approximately 30 to 70%. Mesopotamian admixture suggesting that pre-pottery cultures of Anatolia may have been formed with the contribution of both local hunter-gatherers and migrants from the east where agriculture first appeared. But we cannot model the pottery Neolithic Anatolians with just two sources. Instead, requiring an extra 6 to 20% Levantine Neolithic admixture. The source of the admixture is unclear. It need not have come from southern Levant, Jordan, from which the Levantine Neolithic individuals were sampled. It may instead represent a geographically closer source for which there is no available genome-wide data. For example, from Syria, where early pottery Neolithic cultures such as the Halifian flourish in 4, which the available polymerase chain reaction based mitochondrial DNA data cannot distinguish alternative scenarios. Halifian. Hey, Ivory, you ever heard of the Halifians?
Okay, can you highlight it? Let me see how it's spelled.
Halifians, excuse me.
Oh, yeah, the Harifians. Are they talking about the Harifians mm-hmm. that were living in Sinai in the southern Levant?
No, it says...
It's just Halifian.
In Syria.
Right. There it is.
Oh, in Syria. Oh, they're attached to the Sumara culture or whatever it's called.
They're 6100 BC to 5100 BC early pottery Neolithic, located primarily in the Fertile Valley of the Khabur River, southeastern Turkey, Syria, and northern Iraq.
They have haplogroups for all those samples.
It's found, it's material, influence materials found throughout greater Mesopotamia. So we're talking inland, like basically Iraq, all of Iraq.
And we don't have any DNA on them, it seems.
Yeah, let me try to find some.
But it says
you want some here, Y haplogroups?
Yeah, it says no available genome-wide data, for example, from Syria. Were early pottery Neolithic cultures such as the Halifian flourish and for which the available polymerase chain reaction based mitochondrial DNA data cannot distinguish alternative scenarios. And then it's got a reference here, 23. Oh, this is the this is what Sherry had. I think she shared this one. Sorry. All right, my computer's freezing.
It looks like just make sure I'm.
I think this is very interesting too, where it says we caution that while our results point to migration from and admixture with Mesopotamian and Levantine populations, when we use the term migration, we are not claiming that we have detected a migratory movement. That is a planned translocation of a large number of people over a long distance within the space of years. For discussion of nuances in the use of the term migration, see, and I give you a reference, it's a migration in the sense that we use it may either be intentional or not. It may involve fewer or many individuals, and it may either be rapid or continue across many generations. Some such migration admixture must have taken place as indicated by the genetic data, but its causes, routes, and fine-grained temporality remain to be clarified. Then right here it says, a further caveat is that the Levantine influence detected in the Anatolian pottery Neolithic populations need not have been the result of the unidirectional migration into Anatolia, but may also have come about if Anatolia and the Levant became part of a mating network spanning both regions. Mm-hmm. So that's interesting. So they were swapping back and forth, huh?
Yeah.
All right.
But it makes sense. It makes sense.
And this is 5700 BC, BCE ish.
Somebody get on the bot. Somebody just hit a bot. Somebody please. There's bots. They don't want this going out as usual.
Yeah, I might have to restart my computer because it keeps freezing. But hold on real quick. It says
I got it.
Data from the pottery Neolithic cultures of Levant are needed to test it. Yeah. So it says data from the pottery Neolithic cultures of the Levant are needed to test this hypothesis and determine whether there was movement of mating partners in both directions. So going north and south, huh? The Levantine ancestors
doing that thing.
The Levantine ancestors may have flourished during the Neolithic, and yet its later trajectory in the Levant itself, including individuals from Jordan, Israel, Syria, and Lebanon, exhibits a decrease of approximately 8% per millennium from the pre-pottery and Neolithic down to the medieval period, largely replaced. Here go your favorite word, Ivory. Largely replaced by Caucasus and Anatolian related ancestry from the north and west. This persistent and sustained trend after the formation of the Neolithic West Asian population study here reminds us that large-scale admixture continued in ensuing millennia. Despite the major decline in the contribution of Levantine Neolithic farmers to peoples in the region where they originated, this key ancestry source made a vital contribution to peoples of later periods, continuing until the present and weaving through migrations and mixtures within and beyond the Southern Arc, the tapestry of ancestry of all those that followed them. That's where you get what we started with. The decrease of the Levantine former ancestry, and then the increase of the Caucasian hunter gatherer going towards the Iron Age. And that's that paper there. So that's that paper there. And the other one, let's see, do I have that one open? You know what? Let me refresh my computer because it just keeps slowing down. Somebody please cover the show while I'm gone. No dead air, please.
All right. Maybe. Let me see what I can do.
Where's your paper? Do you have a copy of the paper, Ivory, so we can stay on point?
I don't. I don't have a copy of it. But
we could move to the pigmentation, eye color, hair color, and composite.
Hey, you should before you leave. Give one of us the
share screen. Yeah, share screen.
Somebody do it.
Give it to Adam. you can give it to Adam because Adam.
I can't do it. I got it on my desktop here. I don't know if I can load it up on my my phone.
You can't share on your phone. You can't share on your phone.
Yeah, hold on.
Okay, so yeah, I'm running through the phone, unfortunately.
So let me just email the.
Maybe I could just play a video.
No, I have. Hold on. Let me.
I'll email it to you. Hold on. Let me see if I can. I couldn't get this to download as a PDF earlier. Let me try again.
All right. I could play a video while you're gone too. Like I can play a quick video on the Yumnaya expansion, and we can talk about the Yumnaya when you get back.
Oh yeah,
we haven't touched on them yet.
That's the Southern Arc. It really touched like the Southern Arc paper. Hold on, let me see if I can.
We could just bullshit a bit about that, or pardon my French, discuss the you know what's being found there. Because from my takeaway is the that there's in that Southern Arc there, there's a kind of east-west distribution.
Showing the east-west migration of the Yumnaya, because we was talking about that earlier, and so that would show the migration pattern of the Yumnaya and how the spread of that particular, because we believe that the spread of that particular you know, we have a hypothesis that the spread of those alleles, the light-skinned, blue-eyed, the blue-eyed and the blonde hair allele was also spread by the Yumnaya.
Yeah, but that's they
never picked it up.
That's not the that's the big takeaway from Reich is basically that's old news. That's one of the conclusions is that in fact the Yumnaya did not. Had very little. It was very rare to see light pigmentation. That's one of the new takeaways. So that theory has basically been thrown out with what Reich has published today.
That was what we were discussing earlier when you were saying that the pigmentation of the Yumnaya may have been intermediate to dark.
Yes. Yeah. And that that both blonde hair and blue eyes were present in Anatolian populations. And light skin pigmentation primarily comes from the
Zagros?
No, none of that. It's from the card. Is that what it is? Western European hunter gatherers, I think. So it says here, phenotype distribution of West Eurasian populations. The summary findings are that blue eyes were present in Copper Age of the Levant, Israel, Neolithic of Anatolia, Turkey, and Barsin, and Copper Age of Arslant Steppe, and Tarlasi, and Copper Age, Southeastern Europe, Romania. Blonde hair was present in the Neolithic Anatolia, Turkey, in Barsin, Copper Age, Southeastern Europe, Romania, Copper Age of the Levant, Israel, and the Mannaian. Pale skin was inferred for Copper Age, Southeastern Europe, Romania, Iron Age, Iran, Croatia, and Bulgaria, and Late Bronze Age, Montenegro. Okay. Blue eyes was actually not inferred for all 19 individuals of the Yumnaya cluster examined, and for one of 15 individuals for the Afasivio culture. They were found in high frequency, 29% to 55%, at the later middle to late Bronze Age samples in Russia and Kazakhstan. Populations with elevated Anatolia European farmer ancestry. They were also present in early middle Neolithic farmers from Central Europe. And they were observed at highest frequencies from farmers in Scandinavia and the Baltics and Sweden. Similarly, blonde hair was inferred for only 1 in 34 individuals of the combined Yumnaya and Afasivio clusters, but reached 14% to 60% the aftermentioned later steppe groups. Interestingly, right. Yeah, go ahead.
I'm sorry. I didn't mean to cut your bill. I just went. I think Sherry has the paper. Sherry, you have the paper, so we could put it on the screen. So as Adam is reading along, this way, Adam, as you're reading, like everybody can see it.
Y'all all got the paper now. Sure. Y'all all got it. I just emailed you. I'll be right back. Hey, Ivory, you want to share your screen or anybody want to share the screen? You can show it.
Who?
Oh, sorry, guys.
Yeah, Sherry got it. So, and then Adam, you could continue to read.
Oh, sorry, you got the whole article or what?
Yeah, if you're going to need to go to the.
I'm in the science.org because I have an account. So, y'all just tell me.
If you can go to the. Sure, if you can go to the supplementary. If you can go to the supplementary materials at the bottom there, and the information I'm reading will be in that.
I gotta go all the way to the bottom. Give me a minute.
But this totally blows up the Yamayan blonde hair, blue eyed, light skin.
Right.
Idea.
Right.
It's a combination. It seems to be a combination.
A lot of fortuners are mad right now.
Yeah, it seems to be. Mm-hmm. Yeah, this is the whole Aryan thing is dead as a doorknob too, and they actually make reference to it at the end of this.
They always use.
Mm-hmm.
There's a good meme on YouTube of like the idea of a Chad,
Yep.
There's a YouTube.
Which one? Chad Riders. Sorry, I don't mean to butt in.
Oh, sorry. It's the top PDF there. The PDF file includes materials, methods supplementary. You got it there, yeah. And then we're looking at page 23 of that PDF. Whenever it's ready. Yeah, the Nazis fail. Dead.
Yeah.
Big time.
Yeah.
Always seen those memes.
It is downloading.
Awesome.
All right, we'll just shoot the breeze until.
Yeah, I mean,
I just didn't want you to. Yeah, Adam, I just didn't want you to continue to read without everybody being able to see it. You know what I mean?
You bet.
But you can continue reading once we get it up. But go ahead. What you were saying? You were saying something, Adam.
Yeah, it's the whole Aryan thing. It's great. It's great to kill that because that's a lingering, racist trope
view. Yeah,
That they can't run away from anymore. The Aryan supremacists, which includes a lot of the, bizarrely, from what I've discovered in Clubhouse, including like Hindu nationalists and subcontinent people.
They're using it as well.
Oh yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Turns out those Proto-Indo-Europeans.
28.
Yeah. Actually, sorry. Let me just get it up in front of me. I think it's 20. It's 23.
Oh wait, not that 23. The actual page 23. So that's like 40.
I think you might have the wrong. You might be looking at the wrong paper here. Is this the genetic probe? Genetic probe into the ancient and medieval history of Southern Europe and West Asia. I think that's the other one.
Oh, it's the other one.
Yeah. Okay, so it's the
because this is the right paper that I pulled up just now.
Oh, they're all. Oh, I see. Okay.
It was at the top of the screen. I saw it.
They're all right.
They said that, they said that there was three papers that they were so in conjunction. So, like she said, the actual 23 is not 23 here.
Oh no, that's the so there's three different papers. So she's loaded up the.
I'm gonna get the other one.
So the one you're looking for is at science.com, the genetic probe into the ancient and medieval history of Southern Europe and West Asia.
All right, and I know the page, so I'll come back when y'all see the page on the screen in a minute.
Just back to the last stuff there, but it seems pretty clear that
the kind of western, central, and northern Levant, that there's a kind of Anatolian, PPN, Natufian in the west, and then Caucasus in the east, and then it just seems like around or in that kind of 6,000 to 5,000 BCE, there's the intermixing through that span. I don't know what that looks like in the biblical timeline. Maybe Hebrew, you have that as a point of reference. I think Abraham is
Abraham would be more middle Bronze Age.
Middle Bronze Age, okay.
Yeah. That's at least where I would put him. I think he'll fit best in the middle Bronze Age, because definitely can't put him in the late Bronze Age during the collapse. Can't put him in the early Bronze Age for certain reasons. But yeah, he would fit in a middle Bronze Age, Mesopotamia, and there's two different places he could have came from in terms of like which Ur, because there's an Ur in northern Syria, and then there's an Ur in like southern Mesopotamia.
Yeah. Elkham, Rue.
Okay.
Is this it?
Yeah, let me just take a look there.
Sorry, I don't mean to cut anybody off. Elkham and Rue, you guys, because Shari's up here now, so you guys please watch the bots. In the chat, watch the bots.
Yeah, if you can go up one page, up, you're on the right track there. Sorry, it's 22, pardon me. All right, so table S5 phenotype distribution in West Eurasian populations with at least 5 individuals. To get a better picture of phenotype variation in West Eurasia beyond the Southern Arc, we tabulated phenotype distribution, table S5, in all populations of our data set with at least 5 individuals. We infer the presence of pardon my pronunciation here, depigmented.
Depigmentate.
Sorry, depigmentated, phenotyped.
Depigmented. Right.
In the Southern Arc, listing examples of early regional presence below. Blue eyes were present in Copper Age of the Levant, Israel, and I guess 70 indicates the samples. Neolithic of Anatolia, Turkey, at Barsin 5, and Copper Age of Astrantep and Kamlibel Tarsi 30, Copper Southeastern Europe, Romania. Blonde hair was present in the Neolithic of Anatolia, Turkey. Copper, Southeastern Europe, Romania, copper at the Levant, Israel, and in Minoan 4. Pale skin was inferred from copper, Southeastern Europe, Romania, Iron Age, Iran, Croatia, and Bulgaria, and Late Bronze Age, Montenegro. Did steppe groups possess these traits to a higher frequency than the inhabitants of the Southern Arc? Blue eyes were not inferred for all 19 individuals of the Yumayan cluster examined, table S4, and for one of 15 individuals of the Afasibio culture. They were found at a higher frequency, 29 to 55% at the later middle to late Bronze Age samples. Of the Srubnaya Sintashta cultures and at Kronovarsk in Russia and Kazakhstan, i.e. populations with elevated Anatolian European farmer ancestry. They were also present in early middle Neolithic farmers from Central Europe, including the LBK, first farmers of Central Europe.
Shari, you have to scroll. Shari, you have to scroll.
And global amphora culture. And at the highest of Zerg frequencies in farmers from Scandinavia and the Balkans, EBN Narva in Lithuania, and Matala in Sweden. Similarly, blonde hair was inferred for one of 34 individuals of the combined Yamayan and Afasivio cluster, but reached less than 14 to 60% in the aforementioned later step groups. So that's not Yamayan again, right? Interestingly, light scroll. Pigmentation.
Scroll some. Shall we scroll? We're on page 24 now, right?
Yeah, keep on going up there. There we go. Interestingly, light pigmentation phenotype prevalence was normally higher in the Beaker group, which is Western Europe, then in corded ware, which is kind of Central Eastern Europe, then in the Yamayan cluster, where, as we have seen, it was rare. In reverse relationship to steppe ancestry, and thus inconsistent with the theory that steppe groups were spreading this set of phenotypes. As for the category of pale skin, that is very limited in samples from the Southern Arc as a whole, 1.7%. It appears to have been rare in all studied samples in general, exceeding 1 in 4 in frequency only in medieval Germany, Saxons from England, Central European outliers from late antiquity Italy, pre-Christian Icelanders, with the earliest high frequency found in Bronze Age Levantines at 37.5%. Interesting. So you're seeing a significant 30, over a third of Bronze Age Levantines showing this. Our survey of pigmentation phenotypes is not meant to be a comprehensive treatment of how these varied in space and time, but we highlight three key observations. One, the model phenotype of the Southern Arc in West Eurasia was as expected, one with dark hair, eyes, and intermittent skin pigmentation similar to other Eurasians. Two, the distinctive depigmentation found in modern groups was not associated with a particular type of ancestry in the past, as light eyes and hair were found in both West Asia and Europe, and among early farming steppe pastoral as well as hunter-gatherer groups. Three, the frequency of these traits could have been shaped by migration or by selection, but is more complex than simplistic stories. Example of these traits arising due to sexual selection in boreal hunter-gatherers or spread by steppe Indo-Europeans. Surveying the history of thought of human pigmentation differences, we can remark that the ancient writers of the classical world more or less accurately described the average lighter pigmentation. Can you hear me now?
Oh, you're good. You're good.
Yeah.
All right. Surveying the history of thought on this is really interesting stuff. It's interesting that they kind of go for a bullseye here on this stuff. Surveying the history of thought on human pigmentation differences, we can remark that ancient writers of the classical world more or less accurately described the average lighter pigmentation of populations of Central Northern Europe and the Eurasian steppe, although they lacked the statistical vocabulary to express these in relative terms and exaggerated what various ancient groups, such as the Celts and Scythians, looked like. Their theory that these differences were linked to climate was fundamentally flawed, as we know that people with quite different pigmentation lived in more less similar conditions of, example, Central Europe at the time of farmers, or the medieval period, or the steppe in the early Bronze Age, or the time of the Scytho-Sarmatians, with which they were familiar. The probe.
Hold on, go back to that. Read that part where it says fundamentally false. That theory that these different, read that for me, please, one more time.
Yeah, their theory that these differences were linked to climate was fundamentally flawed, as we know that people with quite different pigmentation lived in more or less similar conditions.
Can we put the climate theory to bed now?
Yeah, a lot of people do stick with that.
Here's the Aryan myth stuff. The promulgators of the Aryan myth also started with the present-day distribution of pigmentation phenotypes and came to a different conclusion, that these were not due to climate dictating a different phenotype for the cold north and temperate south, but rather of the existence of a primordial race of, quote, race of pale, blonde, blue-eyed Proto-Indo-Europeans spreading their languages together with their phenotypes. Thus, they extrapolated the phenotype of some of their contemporaries and medieval ancestors backwards in time, postulating that it was a survival from the remote past that had decreased in frequency as this supposed, quote, race encountered and admixed with other populations. On the contrary, our survey of ancient phenotypes suggests that aspects of this phenotype were distributed in the past among diverse ancestral populations and did not coincide in any single population except as isolated individuals, and certainly not in any of the proposed homelands of the Indo-European language family.
Wow, so pale skin, only it was rare. Pretty much is what he said in a nutshell. It was rare, only isolated individuals. And most of the people in the Southern Arc at this time, in this time depth, would have been an intermediate shade.
Yes, and if you go back to the main page, there's a great graph that shows the figure 6 back on the main page, and it breaks down with a graph years before present of color of eyes, color of skin, color of hair, and composite phenotypes. And it kind of gives you a nice graph distribution over time of what we're seeing in West Eurasia.
Very, very telling. Very, very telling. So next time somebody come on here and say, oh, where's Ankh when you need him? Because Ankh is like, oh, you develop white skin because you're cold. Become cold and the sun's trying to kill you.
It's about halfway down that page there.
He literally said that. I'm not even making that up. Ankh's on video saying the sun was trying to kill us, so that's why we develop white skin.
The sun, why is the sun half feeling?
There it is. That's the graph. So if you look at the top left corner, that's the eyes with the representing brown and the blue representing blue eyes.
Do you want
Darvis? Don't do it.
So I saw it too. I was like, Darvis. Do you want to speak?
Darvis.
And then on the right B, that's the skin pigmentation, and you can see that the orange brown is dark, the brown is dark to black, the pale brown, I'm sorry, I think the color is wrong, is intermediate, and then the pink is pale. And it's the bottom there from left to right is 0 years before present to 15,000 years before present. So you can see if we can take from the genetic information that we can see like 13,000 years ago in West Eurasia, we're seeing overwhelmingly dark with the emergence of dark to black. The entirety of the population there, which I think could suggest is the Natufian and other kind of hunter-gatherer populations. And then the emergence of Dark being the dominant population group, as it was for a short period of time, 14,000 years ago. And that chart kind of, I think, in terms of phenotype, can kind of correspond with the other graph that shows the Levant admixture distribution. There's a bit of a correlation there, you can see. I don't know if we're to, you know, I guess we can infer that the dark to black and the dark represents primarily E, but I mean, that's, you know, we're reaching a little bit there, but I think
all those people in that region, even T and even mm-hmm. some of those J markers,
mm-hmm.
I think they would have had the brown skin as well, until, you know, white skin became pervasive and became a positive selection.
Well, there's the intermediate, which is, I think, what was being read before, being the predominant pigmentation.
Yeah, it's taken a lot of, I can see that it's taken a big chunk of that chart there.
Right. Hey, Darvis, this is way above your pay grade, so just sit back and listen, all right? We'll talk to you on Saturday.
And then you also have a hair color on the bottom left there, with black being the entirety up until 13,000 years before present. And then the emergence of brown, overwhelming the population starting 12,000 years ago, essentially, or say let's say 11,000 years ago to present. You have that blonde introduced around 9,500 years ago. It's not an insignificant population, consistent throughout to present, and the emergence of red around 4,000 years before present. In a very, very slight amount.
So and red, that kind red of... Is, red is pretty new.
Yeah, red is, 4,000. And that's probably a European introduction, right? So that's 2000 BC. I would expect. Of course, it could have just appeared as a trait within the indigenous population, but I would suggest that's probably the more of a European inflow into West Eurasia, 2000 BC.
That skin color map is
possible.
That skin color map is like going to hurt a lot of people's feelings.
Well, you see
if they can even interpret it.
The pale is present in Western Eurasia about 10,500 years before present.
Right. That would be like a few isolated individuals.
Yes. Which is what they suggest, is that the pale was a phenomenon in isolated population groups throughout Eurasia, rather than being a concentrated population, a base population in one particular area.
Avery, I think a particular person is upset at this graph, because he basically said like that type of phenotype didn't exist in those regions.
Does it start with a J?
It starts with a J.
Oh, man.
The usual suspect.
Abraham would have been brown skinned,
mm-hmm.
or the intermediate, which probably is intermediate. Not pale. Yeah, so it's not pale. Like
exactly.
That's crazy.
Yipsa could be upset too.
Yeah, the pink would be pale.
8,500 BC, pale skin in the Eurasia.
Mm-hmm.
And the Yamayan are essentially devoid of it. They're the least likely to be pale skinned, blonde hair, or blue eyed.
Now I got to make another video to address that. That's going to be a while till I do that. But I already made a pre-made video about the Yumnaya and light skin. Now I'm going to have to retract
well, that. All the videos are, I mean, everything is based around that idea. They're going to have to go back to the drawing board for sure. Because that was just the overwhelming theory. I think that might be the biggest.
Yeah, literally everybody on this. YouTube said that and online.
But that's why these studies, cool. These new studies, this, you know, that keep coming out. This is why you have to stay updated. Like everybody's been waiting, especially us. We've been waiting. You know, all the geeks, like you said, Adam, we've been waiting for this. You know, to see what new we could get out of this. You know.
Yeah. Well, I think first on YouTube to analyze all of this information.
Yeah, so I think
shout out to you guys for hosting it.
Actually, you need to make a hashtag issue so when people look up the Southern Arc, one of your videos will be the first one seen.
Yeah. Yeah, this is great. And this paper is only, what, 4 hours old, 3 hours old?
Pretty fresh. I think it came out.
Not since it's been, you know, since it's been published, since we've had access to it. It's only, like, it's hot off the presses. You know,
yeah, it's fresh off the Yumnaya Bear Grill.
I don't think it went into what the phenotypes of the Yumayans are, though. I'm not sure if it referenced that. It just dismissed the idea that they were pale-skinned, blue-eyed, blonde-haired. So I don't know if that's in, I haven't, this is about as far as I've gotten into it thus far. So I'm not sure if it makes reference to what indeed the phenotypes were, you know, the prevalent phenotypes were amongst the Mayan population, but it's interesting. The blonde hair and blue eyes and some of the pale skin is coming out of Turkey.
That's interesting. That dark to black people and black people and intermediate people are predominant. And I don't think that's too many people ready to accept that.
Accept that, yeah. It's gonna be hard.
Well, the good thing about reality is you don't have to accept it. It just is.
It just is, right?
Very well said, Shari. Very well said.
Hey, Sean, look at what. Read that, man.
I see what he said. Above my pay grade, I've been told you that they just popped up and you wouldn't believe me, but you listen to these so-called scientific theories to tell you something I already said. Bro, I'll wait till Saturday to have this discussion with you. I'm not going to do this right now. We got too much meat here. You know, you be playing yourself sometimes, Darvis, but we'll have a discussion on Saturday.
The descendants of the Yumnaya, a lot of them are.
He don't even know who the damn Yumnaya is, you know, but he talking.
For all we know, he could be Yumnaya.
Yeah, he could be. He didn't go
exactly.
Take
it's very possible. Exactly. Down there in Geechee Land.
So I guess it's suggesting that the Yumayan Western flows into Europe, Central Europe, Western Europe in particular, that the pre-existing pale skin traits that were dominant in the population groups there became the dominant trait once the Yumayan overwhelmed those indigenous European populations.
Well, that makes sense because they will say, well, before the Yumnaya got there, it was already in positive selection. So the early European farmers would be the people that they would probably attribute that to.
Right.
The spread of pale skin. And then Yumnaya mixed with them and then they, you know, eventually
continued to spread it.
Yeah.
And it would have predominantly come through the maternal admixture because the Yumayans pretty much genocided the Y haplogroups.
Mm-hmm.
We was talking about that yesterday,
including my own. I'm surprised my peep survived that.
What's your haplogroup again, bro?
I'm I2.
Yeah.
They decimated G. Like I always tell Adam, they got them back though with them Viking raids.
He said the Viking raids.
them Scandinavian Norsemen, the Northmen, you know, fighting them Anglo-Saxons.
Yeah. I think this paper talks about I.
Oh, does it? Oh, I haven't checked it out. I went straight for the anything Levant. I haven't even, you know, and then some of this Yamayan phenotype stuff, but I haven't dug further in. I'd be curious to see what I has, yeah, what they say about I.
We have a lot to go through. It's a lot here. We can't do it all in one day though.
Because I breaks from J 45,000 years ago in the South Caucasus. That makes its way across northern Turkey into the Balkans, and then distributes via the Rhine through to Scandinavia and actually Ireland as well, and into Spain. But the I2 is 25,000 years ago, out of kind of the Balkans, Hungary or something like that. So, and then the Yamayan show up. R shows up, whatever, 4,000 or 5,000 years ago, and just goes to town.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, yeah.
That invention of the wheel got them places real quick.
Yep. All the way to Chad.
Yep.
No.
Yeah, they were rolling over our VA-8 too. I was reading that VA-8 was before the Gennaya.
Yeah.
Let me see.
Did they talk about RV-88?
In this paper, no. Mm. But we read articles before, like the early East European, like old East European. So if you go to the article, let me borrow the screen real quick. So we find a phenotype eye, skin, and hair pigmentation in ancient Western Asia or brown-eyed or of intermediate complexion and brown hair. And let me borrow the screen. So the genetic history of the Southern Arc, a bridge between West Asia and Europe. So, of course, it has 757 individuals of this region in the past 11,000 years. Of course. And then it gives you a nice little graph. Did y'all go over this already?
No.
The graph.
But look at the spread. Yeah, look at the Yamaya. All the way from, like, past. Look at this.
Yeah, going towards China, going all the way to Armenia.
Mm-hmm.
Then look right here. Some migrants bore traces of Anatolian Levantine ancestry coming from this region up into the Pontic Steppes. They're going into Anatolia. They're going into Greece. And then it says Levantine is the orange. Armenia has Levantine, the Anatolians have Levantine, the Greeks, the Balkans, even the Yamaya have a Levantine component.
Yeah, component.
Then the blue is the Caucasus hunter-gatherer. It's something very interesting about that. Hold on, let me get this. It talks about the 727 previously unsampled. Marks, and if anybody's confused about haplogroup R, read this article. If anybody's confused, if you're confused about the Yamaya, read this article. So let me get, and I got something for Tail them if they're watching too. There's something in here for them as well.
Bro.
I'm telling you, man, something in here for everybody. I'm telling you, look. Let me get that. I was just looking at it. The origin and expansion of the steppe pastoralis. It should be under the Y chromosome section. Let me get it. Fluctuating steppe. Y chromosome links between the steppe and West Asia in their genome Y context, right? And they tell you where the Y chromosomes are in the supplemental tables S29 and S34. All right, and then it tells you R, when it inferred common ancestor in the 5th millennium BCE, documents gene flow between the steppe and the southern arc in the Neolithic Chalcolithic period. EV1636 is present in two individuals in the late Chalcolithic at Arslan Tepe in Turkey, in the early Bronze Age Armenia and Kalavan, right? So it gives a great breakdown on R's. It gives you the phylogenetic tree of this R, right? This is RM269, which is inferred to have shared common ancestors in 5th millennium BCE, is crucial for understanding steppe expansions because it was the dominant lineage of the Yamnaya Afanasievo group in the 4th millennium BCE. So watch this. When we go down, it's going to deal with the Yamnaya. And then, Adam, your haplogroup here, it says, despite the Y chromosome moving southward, attested by our data, any association between our haplogroup bearers and Eastern hunter-gatherer ancestors was lost south of the steppe because these had similar proportions of Eastern hunter-gatherer ancestry as IY16419 bearers, the second most prevalent lineage in Armenia. Hmm. Two Bronze to Iron Age sites with substantial sample sizes, unrelated males from Bulgaria, T'Challa. Oh, T'Challa, that's where they get the name T'Challa from. And Narodis have contrasting haplogroup distribution dominated by RM12149 and IY16419, respectively.
T'Challa was R-marker?
I guess, man. It says T'Challa.
Man, listen.
Say it right there.
Might, so it's saying is that I is the prevalent Armenian haplogroup for Bronze Age? Bronze Age Armenia? Interesting.
Bronze to Iron Age sites with substantial sample sizes.
Because, okay, yeah.
Yeah, it says two Bronze to Iron Age sites. Yeah, so two sites with substantial sample sizes, unrelated males from the Bahari T'Challa.
And that's 15,600 years before present.
Wow.
That Apple group.
Yeah. It says suggesting founder events, high genetic drift, or a patrilocal mating system. Approximately 1,000 BCE in Armenia. During the same period at Hasanlu in northwest Iran, many individuals have no trace of Eastern hunter-gatherer ancestry at all, despite the presence of RM12149 there, suggesting that the initial association of this lineage with Eastern hunter-gatherer ancestry on the steppe had vanished as RM12149 bearers reproduced with Southern Arc individuals with out Eastern hunter-gatherer ancestry. We know what that's called. It's called genetic drift. You start losing components after you mix with a population for so long. All right, watch this. I'm gonna get to it.
So I could basically I out. Okay, yeah.
Yeah, I will be representative of the Eastern hunter-gatherer ancestry here.
Right.
Talks about the domestication of the horse. Says, whatever the reason for their demise on the steppe itself, the Yamnaya descendant RZ2103 patrilineage survived in Armenia down to the present day, where this clade is present in appreciable frequencies in all studied Armenian groups, despite the substantial dilution of autosomal steppe ancestry documented in our study. The persistent and lasting presence of Yanaya patrilineal descendants in Armenia contrasts with mainland Europe and South Asia, where steppe ancestry was introduced by people who were not patrilineal descendants of the dominant R12149 lineages of the Yanaya population. Instead, they belong to different descent groups who had received autosomal steppe admixture while carrying different predominant Y chromosome lineages. You hear that, Tao? Let me read that again. So the persistent and lasting presence of United patrilineal descendants in Armenia contrasts with mainland Europe and South Asia, where steppe ancestry was introduced by people who are not patrilineal descendants of the dominant RM12149 lineage of the Yamnaya population. So you can have autosomal components and not be a part of that initial population that had it at the onset. It's just that simple. So you can't, because we got people that's trying to marry the idea of autosomal DNA and sex chromosomes as if they're the same and they both do the same thing. That's not true at all. Let me keep reading this. It says here, instead they belong to different descent groups who have received autosomal steppe admixture while carrying different predominant Y chromosome lineages. Armenia also contrasts with Anatolia, for which no RM269 Y chromosomes are observed at all during the Chalcolithic, Bronze Age, or ancient pre-Roman periods. It says, and in which haplogroups J, 36 individuals, and G, 17 individuals, are most common haplogroup. Most common. Haplogroup J is still common at frequencies of about one-third in present-day people from Turkey, having achieved such prominence despite occurring in only 1 in 18 Neolithic male individuals from Barsin and Yipinar in the Marmara region during the pre-Chalcolithic period. A likely explanation for the haplogroup J increase is that it accompanied the spread of Caucasus hunter-gatherer ancestry inferred by admixture analysis. This inference is made plausible by the fact that both Caucasus hunter-gatherer individuals from Kotayas and Satserbia and Mesolithic individual from Hotu Cave and Iran belong to this lineage, suggesting its very old presence in the Caucasus Iran region, in contrast with haplogroup G, which occurred in the majority 10 to 18 individuals from the Neolithic Marmara region. By the Chalcolithic, haplogroup G and J were ubiquitous in Anatolia, each making up 10/28 males on that period, paralleling the homogenization that had occurred by that time.
So that's pre-Bronze Age.
So nothing really changes with that J mark.
Exactly. Yeah, that's pre-Bronze Age.
That's pre-Bronze Age. That J marker
still comes from the north to the south.
Yes, but its presence, it's present and dominant in pre-Bronze Age Anatolia, rather than in Bronze Age Anatolia.
Yeah, which makes sense, because remember those two cultures. Remember we read earlier on the graph on the PCA that they tightly clustered with the Cypress individuals.
Yeah,
which also would have J markers.
And these J markers are specifically bringing Caucasus hunter gatherer DNA, which again illustrates the north to south migration.
But it's probably north. It's probably north to from South Caucasus to North Mesopotamia, and then from North Mesopotamia west to Anatolia.
Yeah. Watch.
As we looked at before when they were talking about the west east pan southern arc integration between like Natufian and Neolithic Anatolians with, or so not Anatolians,
Yeah, Anatolians with the northern Mesopotamians.
Right. Watch this.
Mm-hmm. I think this next space though, with the you removed the page with the Indo European Hittites. I think that would have been pretty interesting to get into.
Yeah, that would be interesting.
Yeah. Let me read this real quick.
All right.
This is the supplemental for that paper. It says, thus the entire clay JP58 is well established with the Levant region, may have expanded beyond it towards Armenia and Iran by the Bronze Age, and even more broadly, at least in the Mediterranean world in latter periods. The earliest known examples are from Syria and Southeast Turkey. The earliest known examples are from Syria and Southeast Turkey, consistent with the suggestion based on modern variation that the expansion of this haplogroup occurred from Northeast Syria, Northern Iraq, and Eastern Turkey.
Right, right.
P58 does not start in Israel.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't. The evidence doesn't point to that conclusion. It said the Bronze Age. Go ahead.
No, I was just about to say, it's even evident with the fact that they have Caucasus DNA and not Levantine or Natufian DNA. Because if the J marker started in the Caucasus, the J marker started in the Levant, they should have Natufian or Levantine Neolithic DNA, but they don't.
Don't you understand, brother, that that's Abraham? Don't have to with Abraham coming down.
You keep invoking this dude, yeah.
That's the Abraham chase coming down into the Levant. You know, because he's actually the only J1 marker there because he's an invader.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, he was funny in
the
part?
Arc, though. You can't forget the arc part. He was an arc.
And the crazy part is there's continuity in these genomes. Like, there's no bottleneck event. And if there was supposed to be a flood that happened in, like, the Black Sea or something, how come there's no major bottleneck? It looks like these populations were mixing and migrating for thousands of years with no major bottleneck, like a flood.
No, Ivory, no. There was a flood on the coast of Madagascar.
But the thing is that JP58 does, and I think it's going to say it here, but I like when I saw Northeast Syria, and you think about the proto-Semitic origin, that's exactly bullseye, right? Especially with the times being suggested.
Yeah, no one disagrees that they help spread Semitic. I don't agree that they are proto-Semitic. That's two different things.
Right. Because remember, proto-Semitic... Oh, my bad. Go ahead.
Go ahead, brother. You was about to go in.
Yeah, because remember, proto-Semitic emerged from Afro-Asiatic. Proto-Semites are just descendants of Afro-Asiatics that just split off and formed their own version of the subgroup of Afro-Asiatic languages. So they would have still likely been, you know, E-markers, like all other Afro-Asiatic populations.
All right, let me read the rest of this. Watch this. But I actually read this before I jumped on. It says the Bronze Age distribution of this clade in all Levantine countries, Syria, Lebanon, Israel, and Jordan. The inferred recent Neolithic to Bronze Age origin of clades within the JP58 lineage in the present day distribution in diverse groups of Semitic speakers all also combine to support its association with the expansion of Semitic languages. The latter has been dated to the early Bronze Age approximately 5,750 years ago by the Bayesian linguistic phylogenetics, with a first split of the West Semitic from Akkadian and a common ancestor of the West Semitic languages approximately 5,400 years ago. All samples certain JP58 chromosomes post-date this period and could thus be associated with this expansion. We caution, however, that the early splits within the Semitic language family were inferred to have transpired within a millennium, and the linguistic affiliation of the ancient individuals is uncertain. Yeah. Although some form of Semitic language is quite plausible.
And it said associated twice.
Go back though, because that part though, where it says
they post date.
Yeah, post date. That was
these clays they find there is like 1,000 years. It says here to have transpired within a millennium.
Mm-hmm. And that's why I always try to explain to the guy on Facebook, and not gonna name his name, but those J markers weren't part of the proto-Semitic population until 1,000 years later. And who would have been those proto-Semites before the J markers entered the population? It would have been E markers.
No, you're wrong. You're anti-Semitic. Delete your YouTube channel. Anyway, it says, although some form of Semitic language is quite plausible given their time and place, so an association of JP58 with either the Semitic linguistic family as a whole or any of its daughter languages must be clarified by additional ancient DNA study of diverse ancient populations of known or highly likely linguistic affiliation.
Mm-hmm. So the quest continues.
Yes. Yeah.
But they did. They did play a part because they were there. They came in influx.
Yeah, they came in about 1,000 years later.
Yeah, they influx.
And they would have helped. Yeah, they would have helped spread it.
Yeah. I found it quite interesting because it very much so clarifies where this clay was coming from.
But then Abraham is 1,000 years after JP58 shows up, right?
I mean,
no, Abraham
is.
Well, it depends where do you date him? So I date him around 21st, 22nd century BCE.
Yeah, I'm the same.
So that's like, say, 2000 BC.
Round about.
Right. So yep. The JP58 is 3,750 BC. So we're talking like 1,700 years.
No. The JP58 is there like 25. It's definitely before him. It's definitely there in large numbers, actually.
Almost 2 millennia.
No. Abraham. No. What part are you saying? What part?
Because I think it says that that the latter has been dated to early Bronze Age 5,750 years ago.
Yeah, that's where they posit that the Semitic language.
Oh, the language. Arose. And J58 is postdates this period.
Yes.
But what is the? Does it say where the first P58 is? Like what?
No, it says what the earliest they found was in Syria and eastern Turkey.
But what time? What year is that? Like how many years ago?
I have to reference the reference here 469. Let me get that. Those people that live in Turkey, northeast Syria, I don't think, unless you're saying, are you saying that Semitic languages emanate from northern Syria or Turkey?
Yes, that's that's from northern Syria is the proto-Semitic origin. That's the most recent hypothesis.
Interesting.
Well, we know in Anatolia, there would have been the Anatolian branch of Indo-European languages.
Which this paper says that Yamnaya is pretty much the father of all Indo-European languages.
Yes. Yeah.
And then by this time, we're quite a ways down the tree from when the analysis, going back 14,000 years ago to present, of the Anatolian autosomal DNA distribution, right?
I'm sorry, say it again. I'm trying to find this.
I mean, I guess E is still prevalent, but like from the other findings there, it was saying that like, let me get the reference. Sorry, when we were looking at the Anatolian sort of Copper Age genetic admixture, like we have Caucasus hunter-gatherer, right? That you see the Caucasus hunter-gatherers coming from north and east to the west.
Yeah, so that's congruent.
Are you talking about the T markers or the J markers? Because there was T markers with Anatolian DNA. in the Levant. The Pekin
cave. Yeah, I mean, it could be the tea, but this might also be non-Y. Like that could have been, that might have been females. Non-Y. Yeah.
Women.
Yeah. Yeah. Which would then suggest that it was males going, I guess, going east and intermix from like the PPN and Natufian, going east and north, and interbreeding, intermixing with women there, and then south and west. And then the P58 is a Y outflow from the South Caucasus, or from
into
that region later on.
My question would be, how did, because Semitic languages stem from Afro-Asiatic, so then you have to say that a population transplanted that to them, or they were a part of a population that were Afro-Asiatic, in order for them to develop the Semitic language.
Are you talking about the J markers or the E markers?
I'm talking about the J markers, because he said it's, I guess he's trying I guess he's saying that since they're the oldest samples are in East Turkey and Northeast Syria, that they're Semitic. But then you have to say, okay, where are these Semitic people coming from? Like, where's the Afro-Asiatic before them so they can even develop or branch off into Semitic?
Well, there are a couple of different hypotheses for the origins of Afro-Asiatic. Most of the origins of Afro-Asiatic are in Africa. So it could be the Horn of Africa, could be North Africa during the Green Sahara, could be, you know, the Eastern Sahara near the Nile Valley, in all these different places in Africa. Of course, there's the Levantine origin of Afro-Asiatic with the Natufians, and you know, we go with that for more biblical model. But if we were to go with a secular model and say that Afro-Asiatics originated in Africa, and you know, these Afro-Asiatics would have had haplogroup E, as most papers say, then this would represent populations of E markers going into the Levant, which kind of fits this paper talking about how Natufians have a North African gene flow. So Proto-Afro-Asiatics coming from North Africa into the Levant, which, you know, which would be a branch of the ancestors of Semitic populations. So these pre-proto-Semites would have still carried E markers, and then J markers would have like entered into the population, like joined with them and adopted the language.
Yeah. So what I was saying is, if you go to infer that these people actually were Semitic, then you're also inferring that prior to them being Semitic, they were Afro-Asiatic.
Yeah, which would have been E markers that were
right.
Yeah,
mm-hmm. Like English comes from a Proto-Indo-European language, so the people either got it from people that had Proto-Indo-European languages at the onset, or themselves they were already speaking Proto-Indo-European languages, and then they developed their own branch of PIE.
But it's interesting to note that it appears that with the advent of agriculture, you're seeing the emergence of Semitic and and Indo-European languages, both originating from that kind of southeast Turkey, northern Syria region, just at different times. And they're not related linguistically, which is interesting.
Read the paper. It talks about that Indo-European actually became like a lingua franca of that region during that time. Let me see if I can find that.
Was there that 469? Was there a reference to that?
Yeah, I found it, but I can't get. It's the you've seen that paper before, the J1E paper.
Oh, okay.
You know what I'm talking about?
2001? Yeah, 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 yeah.
But I can't find the supplementals on it. So see if you can find the supplementals on that to get the thing, the the Syria, if you don't mind.
Yeah, I'll take it.
What was I talking about? Oh, the Lingua Franca. Let me see if it's here. And then we'll close, because I told y'all, brothers, I'm not staying up till.
Man, you already got me up. You already got me up to almost midnight, man.
Yeah, I'm not doing it this time, man.
This is something that we're gonna have to over a few lives, because there's so much here that has to be touched on. So I'm hoping we revisit this a couple of times.
Yeah.
Oh, right here. Here it is. It says, did the early Indo-European language become successful in Southeastern Europe because it functioned as a lingua franca?
Can't see your screen, by the way.
All right. Hold on. Yeah, right here. Says, did the early Indo-European language become successful in Southeastern Europe because it functioned as a lingua franca, facilitating communication among speakers of the diverse languages of previous farmer and hunter-gatherer populations? And this is when it's breaking down the different clades of the R, the beaker associated clades and stuff of that nature. Right, it says in Southeastern Europe during the Bronze Age, we detect Y chromosomes belonging to haplogroups R, J, I, and G, linking it with Central Northern Europe in the steppe West Asia local hunter-gatherers, Anatolian European Neolithic farmers, respectfully, together with the extraordinary heterogeneity of autosomal ancestry in the Balkans. A picture emerges in a fragmented genetic landscape that may well parallel the poorly understood linguistic diversity in the ancient Balkans, which among Indo-European languages includes Paleo-Balkan speakers before the spread of Latin and Slavic, with Albanian as the only surviving representative. Did the early Indo-European languages become successful in Southeastern Europe because it functioned as a lingua franca, facilitating communication among speakers of the diverse languages of previous farmer and hunter-gatherer populations? All right.
Interesting.
All right. All right. So 2 hours, 30 minutes. Did you find those two samples?
It's in an XLS, so I have to load it up here.
It's a spreadsheet. So you found it. How did you find it? Because I went to that page and it was like.
Yeah, it's under the supplementary information at the bottom. There's two. XLS files.
Okay. Because I went here. I went to the references on here. Actually, when you go down and you go to 469.
Yep.
There it is. It's that paper right here. The emergence of Y chromosome haplogroup J1E among Arabic speaking populations. So if you click the PubMed,
yeah,
it takes you here. You see that? You can go to the PMC.
Yeah, so if you go to the bottom there, it should be. Weird. Why did I get to a different?
No, this is the National Library of Medicine.
Oh, so the one I got was the nature.com. I went to the European Journal of Human Genetics. Yeah, and that one has the supplementary tables.
Yeah, let me get. I was like, why is this not showing the whole.
How did I end up at a different link than you? That's weird. Oh, because I went through the. The supplementary materials link, which links to the nature.com, where the one on the main page goes to the PubMed.
Oh, okay.
That's what happened.
All right, so it says G1E by population. All right, so that was not, it's not what I'm looking for. We're gonna set up a discussion with Avery and what's that brother's name? Darvis.
Wait, what?
Marvelous.
You said Adam's gonna have that discussion. That's a good idea. Right.
You know what? That would be hilarious. Let's get Adam and Darvis to have a discussion.
Who's Darvis?
Oh boy,
you'll find out Saturday.
Yeah, you'll find out.
Am I the spawn of Satan? Or am I like an alien that was brought in?
Well, you're all of that.
We'll find out Saturday, my brother.
It's a five-way model. It's a five-way model on the PCA chart.
I'm 10% not European, so there you go. And I got 3-4% Natufian in my some of my ancient DNA analysis.
Really, I don't think Darvis goes by any of those.
Yeah,
things.
Yeah, none of that.
Oh, gotcha.
Matter.
Okay.
None of that's
gonna
Oh man.
I got freckles as well, so there you go.
Oh, that's even worse.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, so maybe it's actually because I just looked through the supplemental that it. I mean the. The charts, that didn't help at all. Let me see if it's actually listed out in the actual article.
Yeah, because it's saying here, where is it now? Too many tabs, nature, where are you?
So there is an expansion time. So northern and inner Syria. Four thousand years. And so Turkey, 5,000 years. But I don't know if that's going to be helpful.
So they're dating the Proto-Semitic age to the Bronze Age, 5,500 to 3,500 BCE. So they give a pretty big range.
Yeah. So they basically they date the language to see how, just like they do genetics to see, oh, well, mutation has a certain rate or whatnot. But they do some similar in languages, how long it takes for a language to develop and diverge. So they do that as well. They do that with Bantu languages. So they say, oh, the Bantu language emerged 5,000 years ago. Therefore, that's when the Bantu expansion happened. Like some certain people think that way, but that's not. It's not one on one. It doesn't go hand in hand like that. For J1E, the Zagros-Taurus Mountain region displays the highest haplotype diversity, although J1E frequencies increase towards the peripheral Arabian Peninsula. All right, man. That's a homework assignment.
Yeah, it's in there somewhere. It's too bad he doesn't just reference that that date when he makes reference to it.
Yeah. See, material.
I guess they're expecting that you know this material. Like, I guess he's expecting that most people that's going to be reading this know most of the material and most of the data that preceded this. So, you know, his work, Lazarus' work. You know, so that's probably why it's not there.
So they're saying in the paper here, the time and the geographic distribution of J1E is represented by the expansion of agriculturalists and herder hunters from the pre-pottery Neolithic to the late Neolithic era. The expansion time associated with Yemen is 7,000 BCE.
Yeah, but where's the clay? I mean, a sample.
Right.
Because yeah, there's supposed to be two samples that we're looking for. We're looking for one in Turkey and the other in Northeast Syria, which is supposed to be like the oldest representatives of the P5A clade.
I think the oldest P58 in Syria is the one found in Ebla, and that's from like the Middle Bronze Age.
All right, well, I'll have to see if I can get the. Did you open up those supplementary tables?
Yeah,
they, and it didn't
not help.
It didn't really.
They didn't list out dates and times and everything right next to it like normal humans would do. Wait, hold on, wait a minute. Let me try that. Let me try this. Because I was looking at the spreadsheet.
I think it might be origin, diffusion, and differentiation of Y chromosome haplogroups groups E and J. And this is from two. You think they'd have new samples. Like, why? That's a little disappointing, actually, that of all the new samples here, there's nothing more to show.
Yeah,
I have to reference other papers.
I'm pretty sure it's like an up-to-date graph that might have it. But for now, I'm getting ready to shut this show down. I'm going to sleep, y'all. Darvis held me hostage last night. To like 1 o'clock.
All right, family. Yeah.
Hope y'all learned something, man. I would have had a little bit more energy and pep in my step today if we didn't do that long, live last night.
Y'all messing around with Darvis last night.
Hey, that's your friend.
I think him and Yashar coming fast buddies.
You said they becoming buddies?
Yeah, they're becoming fast buddies.
There's in the chat, there's I guess some people that came in late that are asking for like a maybe I'm looking at a synopsis, but I think
that was hours ago. Let's see. Where is it at?
We're up to date then, okay. Darvis asked, where was the oldest haplo group that represents pale skin found?
Would you like to answer that for him, Adam?
That Serbia cave.
Because we did read it. We did read it, didn't we?
Well, I think it was 8,500. Isn't it 8,500? Well, we know in the Near East it's 8,500 BC.
Yep.
And it's in I think it was southern Turkey. But I don't know what the haplogroup is.
He didn't mention any spaceships, by the way.
I was about to say that's when Darvis proposes that the Nephilim came down and struck everybody with leprosy.
But even 800, like 8,500 BC in southern Turkey, what's the predominant haplogroup there? Probably E. Right?
Wait, when? When? What time?
8,500 BC. 10,500 years before present is when pale skin emerges in the Near East.
I know the Natufi is stretched all the way up there, so possibly they could have been there. We know that because their material culture is there.
It could be I though, right? Because we saw that I is. Though that's later.
That's what melted. Well, it's kind of hard to say because that region right there, like a lot of people are crossing through that region. And like we said, you can see the migration because you see H over here, and then this article is basically proposing that people are going back and forth. So, and that's probably why. No, I'm not gonna say that because I think T is actually in Near Eastern. I think T has been in the Near Eastern region for a long time. Well, not Near Eastern because Near Eastern is huge, but I think it's been in Southern Levant or nearby it for a long time. Well, anyway, man.
Yeah, I don't think we have a haplogroup for you there, Darvis. But I'll pick through it here as I continue to read because I'm Pacific Standard Time, so it's still early for me.
Yeah. Well, we're going to let you sit up and do your thing. You can hang out. Tell Jarvis to...
Hey, you got a YouTube channel, Adam? Up on
Clubhouse, yeah.
Yeah, no YouTube channel, but Clubhouse for sure, yeah.
I was about to say, if you can get on YouTube, have Darvis come on your channel.
Well, hey, whatever.
Bro.
Yeah.
You'll be up until God knows what time. All right, y'all ready to shut down?
I don't know what the hell a Tolian is. Yeah, I'm shutting down. I don't know what that is. Hey, Darvis, I'll see you Saturday, man. Yeah.
David Reich. Yep, David Reich delivered. Good man.
Yeah.